Hello students, today let's study about the nitrogen metabolism. At first, let's know the sources of nitrogen. That we all know that you have lightning, inorganic fertilizers, animal residues, crop residues, organic fertilizers and nitrogen fixation. Nitrogen fixation is what we'll get on to the later slides. See, although most of the atmospheric air consists of nitrogen, none of us have the capability to directly utilize that nitrogen for useful results, you know. And you need the nitrogen for all the basic components like DNA, RNA and all the proteins have been made up. Luckily, we have microorganisms to do that. And they have these amazing capability to directly convert these nitrogen to ammonia, and that's what we are going to study in this video tutorial. And it's been done by multiple subsequent step process. And now we have this slide saying it's a nitrogen fixation, the term nitrogen fixation. And why is that nitrogen fixation? The word has been used, fixation word. Is that because there is something to be fixed or it is something to be adjusted in such a way that a desirable product is obtained. Nature is itself has made certain changes such that the nitrogen is being always fixed. You know, the breaking up of the strong triple bonded nitrogen atom structure in a way makes it interesting. And that's the beauty of it. How it does it and what is all the process involved, we'll study further down the line. And if nature, you know, the beauty of it is that if nature doesn't want it to be fixed, it would have made the plants itself to evolve in such a way that it can directly consume that nitrogen and get it into useful product. But it has not been doing that. In some way it is getting fixed, and that's what nature intended to be so. Next we have moving on, we have these three types. Basically we have three types of nitrogen fixation. You have a biological type of nitrogen fixation and you have non-biological fixation. Non-biological nitrogen fixation, you can also, there are two types. One you can call it as a physical mode of nitrogen fixation, and one more type you can call it as a chemical way of nitrogen fixation. I told you it's a three-step process. It's a very three types. But in biological fixation you have another two types, that is symbiotic and asymbiotic. Okay. Now we have atmospheric nitrogen to be converted into ammonia or nitrates. So how is that? Is if it is going to combine with the hydrogen, and it makes ammonia, and if it's going to convert with oxygen, it's going to give us nitrates. Okay. Whether it's combining with hydrogen and whether it's combining with oxygen, that is all the whole matters. So coming up to the non-biological fixation of nitrogen, you have this atmospheric fixation where, you know, a high electric discharge of lightning which makes the fixing of nitrogen. And second, you have these synthetic or industrial or chemical type of fixation, where it's a very famous, you have Haber-Bosch process, where the hydrogen is being, you know, artificially mixed with the nitrogen gas to react. And you also have this equation over here, and you get the ammonia, which the ammonia is later on used as fertilizer. So how is this atmospheric fixation is being done? That's the main criteria here. This atmospheric fixation, you have only just about 5 to 8% of fixation of nitrogen which gives you ammonia, which gives you nitrates. That is this enormous, you know, lightning has this enormous of energy, which you know, they just strike into the atmospheric air and breaks apart the nitrogen molecules apart, and these nitrogen atoms combine with oxygen to form nitrogen oxides. And these nitrogen oxides, they then again dissolve to the rain and form nitrates, which are you know, dissolved in the groundwater. It gets carried away in the ground and in the form of rain, and this can be used by the plants, you know, to grow. These nitrates can be utilized by the plants in the later form. And then you have this industrial fixation. What happens in industrial fixation is, that is what I told you, the second type of fixation of nitrogen. That is, you can call it as a chemical fixation or a synthetic process, yeah, whatever you may call. But this is, you know, and this how it happens is that under a very great pressure, maybe at a temperature of 600 degrees Celsius with the use of a couple of catalysts, what you do is you have this atmospheric nitrogen and then you have it combined with the hydrogen and you get ammonia. And later on, you know that the ammonia can be used as a fertilizer. Next, we have these biological fixation, and here is the most of the biologically most of the nitrogen is being fixed. Okay, majority of the fixing of nitrogen is being seen here, and you have the free living bacteria which fixes about 30% of nitrogen, and you have a symbiotic relationship bacteria which fixes around 70% of nitrogen. And we have here, so we also have the types of biological fixation, you know, biologically nitrogen, how it has been fixed. There are plenty. You have obligate anaerobic bacteria like Clostridium. You have facultative anaerobes like Klebsiella. You have photosynthetic bacteria like Rhodobacter. And you have obligate aerobes like Azotobacter there. And also you have symbiotic bacteria, many cyanobacteria like Nostoc. And in case of very, what makes the Nostoc very interesting is that when we study this Nostoc, we will come across this some specialized cell called heterocyst, right? Very importantly, these heterocysts are region which are present in cyanobacteria are made in such a way that or it's been developed in such a way that it has very low concentration of oxygen, so that very less photosynthesis is happening and they are more focused on conversion of nitrogen. So why am I telling all these things? It's because there is a reason for it. Okay, understand one thing also, and this is a fact, that if the nitrogen has to be converted to ammonia, we need the nitrogenase enzyme that to be working. Okay, if there is nitrogenase enzyme, then the nitrogen is being converted to ammonia. So that's a fact. And what happens is that nitrogenase enzyme is good, is at its best only when there is absence of oxygen. You know, then the oxygen actually blocks the conversion or inhibits the conversion of the process of converting this nitrogen into ammonia. So what happens is that you have these nitrogenase enzyme which mainly functions in the absence of oxygen. So as I mentioned, in these particular heterocysts, you have less number of oxygen, so that the cyanobacteria mainly concentrate on the, you know, to fix the nitrogen. So that's what we are worried about. And this another picture is about root nodules, where the 70% of the nitrogen is fixed through the symbiotes. So we have the free living and symbiotic type of nitrogen fixation. Okay. Let me just select the pen over here. Okay. When they come in contact, these root hair is the first first line of contact there, which the rhizobium gets into. See, these rhizobium are always there here freely, there in the ground, soil. As soon as they, come in contact with the root hair, they just come and degrade the root hair, and they invade the tissue and produce the infection thread. You know, this is how you are saying here in the second diagram, how the rhizobium is getting in contact with the root hair and these degrading this cell wall. In a way, this they just the rhizobium, they come in contact to the root hair and they produce an infection thread, and they migrate, they migrate towards the cortical region and make a compartment here, and make a compartment or small space, a small room like thing in a cellular membrane with high percentage of vacuole, and bacterial structure is been produced. That is the whole criteria, or how, that is the whole intention of getting into it. And what happens is that these root hairs have lectins. Okay, these root hairs have at the margin of the root hairs, you have something called lectins, that are carbohydrate binding proteins. And these here you have these lectins. You have lectins over here, which have the carbohydrate binding proteins. And you have something similar type of structure on the surface of the rhizobium, which have been attracting to this lectins. You know, that works. That is what makes them to get into contact. And these are something like they are receptors, which makes the rhizobium has these receptors, which form the binding complex. Complex structure. And these root hairs are made up of polysaccharide layer, cellulose polysaccharide layer with lectins, so that these rhizobium are readily attracted to these. They're always ready to bind to these root hairs and get invaded. And also, even in a way, the even plant also need these rhizobium to get attached. Why does this has this lectins, which has some attractive complex, which has the rhizobium to get it attracted? Let us not worry about that. We'll get into it in consequent slides. And now here, what happens is that in the third diagram, you are able to see that these rhizobium are heavily crowded near the root hairs. They just come and bind and come and bind. Many of it just bind there. And there is this synthesis of cytokinin. Cytokinin, we all know that it's a cell division hormone, which is responsible for a cell division. They just make a clump or mass of cells, which makes them to curl inside due to their heavy mass of cells. And auxins are being created, and IAA has been synthesized for the curling of the root hair, and at a very higher amounts. These regions, they divide very rapidly, and root hairs start to curl after rhizobium contact it stops. So after the infection, the bacteria moves towards the cortex. This is the fourth diagram over here. This is the depiction of how the movement of this bacteria towards the cortical cell in search of these cells, which are heavily vacuolated, so that they can find a very good shelter. It just penetrates to the cortical region, and they just be there. And it may be the cell membrane of the plant, or the bacteria may create. That is up to the further proving evidences. But let us not worry, nonetheless, that these produce some kind of vacuolated cell. They call it as a peribacteroid membrane. And finally, these peribacteroid membrane, after finding a huge vacuolated cell that forms a nodule. That what's the give us the root nodules which have been given here. Now this nitrogen, the fixing of nitrogen, the whole concept is that the rhizobium wants to take up the food for its own functionality, and the attachment with the root hairs with the help of lectins are the carbohydrate binding proteins with the free rhizobium is for its own protection, you know, to have its good sheltered there. But in a way, in turn, that is why it is called symbiosis. In a way, the plant utilizes the fixing of nitrogen as ammonia for its own good. You have this infection process in a very point system, as I mentioned before, that you have the attachment site on the root hair, where it may attach wherever there are presence of lectins, the carbohydrate binding proteins. And secondly, you have this root hair curling because of the synthesis of cytokinins and auxins and things like that. And you have a localized cell wall which is being degraded. Obviously, it has to degrade the localized cell because it cannot move on further to proceed with the infection. And you have the infection threat, that is the movement of the bacteria towards the corticular region. And after moving on to the cortical region, you have differentiation within those cells, and the rhizobium is released into the cytoplasm so that it can make use of its functionality. And further on, we have this bacterioid differentiation. In this fourth diagram, you can clearly see this, that the meristem has been infected, the infection thread has been moved, and now the development of symbiotic relationship ultimately giving us the nitrogen fixation. This doesn't infect any of the vascular nature of the plant, where the vascularity of it is not affected. Only the corticular regions has been infected there, and then finally you have the nodule formation. And the root nodule, in root nodule, the formation of rhizobium, as I told you, these corticular cells are there, and in rhizobium, the bacteria they just come and attaches to the root hair, and everything has been done. And that is how, in the third diagram, the movement of infection thread is being seen. See, they have showing you how the movement of the infection. And at the last diagram, you can see how the bacterioid has completely utilized its space of peribacterial membrane in order to have its own infection strategy. And you have this slide, this D micrographic of developing root nodule, just to show how the intense is this infection. And even then, if though it may infect so good, and it doesn't change in any way the metabolism of a plant. The metabolism of a plant is going on. That is, it's no way it has been concerned. Look, now understand one thing. In root nodules, the oxygen level is regulated by a special hemoglobin enzyme complex called leghemoglobin. Okay, understand this one. You have a specialized hemoglobin enzyme complex where the globulin protein is sensor encoded by the plant genes. The plant bring the globulin protein, okay, the plant bring the globulin protein, but the heme factor, the red color or pinkish color which is there present in the root nodules, is being brought by the bacteria. So the bacteria brings the heme thing, and the globulin protein complex is brought by the plant. And it is further on, it's just is what made the symbiotic bacteria, and this is produced only when the plant is infected with rhizobium. See, the plant is synthesizing the globulin protein, and the bacteria is coming up with the heme protein. It's only synthesized when the plant has been infected. The plant root cells convert the sugar to organic acids, which they simply supply to the bacterioids. In exchange, the plant receives the amino acid in a symbiotic relationship. The bacteria just receives it, and the legume plant is providing the shelter to the bacteria for the exchange of the plant carbon, and also this bacteria is getting a protected home. So that's the basic idea. That is what you have to understand basically. So there are multiple biochemical changes which are there happening, where the nitrogenase is blocked by oxygen and the plant and bacterial cell produce leg hemoglobin binding complex to the oxygen to be blocked, and it's a multiple step process, and you have control mechanisms also further down the line. We'll get into that. And next we have we'll get into the biochemical changes in bacteria. We all know that nitrogenase enzyme is very important because it helps convert nitrogen to ammonia. But this can be blocked by oxygen. So plant and bacteria together produce a leg B protein, where the leg by plant and heme by bacteria to bind to oxygen prevent it to enter into bacterial cell. All we know up to this particular point. Now the nature should have a control over these converting of nitrogen to ammonia. If every time all this process has been happening, then that may be fatal to the plant, or it may be harmful. Why? Because it needs a lot of energy, this converting process. Also, why is this taking a lot of energy? Is because it's a multiple step process that involves many protein complexes and different genes, so that if conversion goes on, this loses a lot of energy and other metabolic activity of the plant may be compromised. So what does that do is the plant introduces carbon monoxide into the picture. See, now what we have here is just that you have an oxygen. So in order to block it, you have these leg hemoglobin complex, enzyme complex, so that it just keeps with it the oxygen which has been blocked. So now we know this much. So in order to control this, you know, the mechanism of this, that in order to you know, always been the nitrogen converted into the ammonia, this process has always it couldn't happen all the time. So you need to have a put a break, or you need to give a rest or some time for the plant to, you know, get on to the other metabolic activity. So generally what does it do is that it introduces one more participant, that is it is carbon monoxide. That is being introduced by plant, you know, the plant introduces, where this particular carbon monoxide, they just bind to the enzyme complex over here. They just you know, the produced by the introduced by the plant, which binds to the leg hemoglobin. Also, it also blocks the nitrogenase enzyme, which is there all the time. You know, I'm writing over here because this is nitrogenase complex on the bottom of the page, but I'm just writing here for your understanding that this carbon monoxide not only blocks this thing, also it blocks this oxygen, where in turn it blocks the whole leg hemoglobin component. So that is why this carbon monoxide has been introduced when it is in need. So that what is that is that it's a double action. It is like a regulator which regulates the mechanism of converting the nitrogen to ammonia. So now what did he understand all this by? Well, this means that the plant wants it to be controlled, you know. So the plant will say to the bacteria when it is in need of nitrogenase compound, because bacteria do not want this to happen. Because always see, for bacteria, this particular exchange or this particular conversion is always resourceful for the bacteria. It's, why it is resourceful? Because its whole metabolic activity is this, that the conversion of nitrogen to ammonia. That is why it is there. But the plant doesn't allow, but the plant says otherwise. It says that no, this is not happening. You work only when I say you to work. So the, what happens now is that the carbon monoxide, which has been introduced by the plant, says that it is, no, now it is time to block this oxygen, enzyme complex and also nitrogenase, so that it is withholding the process. And the plant produces food and supply to the bacteria. So this is how the bacteria survives now. And it always works like that, and it is always through the signaling pathway. But now when it needs ammonia, all of a sudden, now again the signaling is being reinstated. And it happens so that the bacteria is told to convert the carbon monoxide to carbon dioxide. So now the plant again it introduces this carbon monoxide to in order to change into the carbon dioxide. Okay, this carbon monoxide has been converted to so it makes the enzyme possible, so that it withholds by the signaling pathway, and this carbon monoxide converts this into carbon dioxide. And how does that do that? It's because by the help of an enzyme carbon dehydrogenase, you know. So it's very difficult to write in this. Okay, so this, with the help of carbon dehydrogenase enzyme, which is used to lift up the carbon monoxide and convert it into carbon dioxide. Okay, then this carbon monoxide comes down, and as a result of the decaying, this whole thing gets decayed. The whole thing, after it's decaying, the like hemoglobin and the nitrogenase activity will start. And as a result, ammonia is again created by nitrogenase enzyme. Nitrogenase enzyme complex is over here at the bottom. So again, the bacteroid to produce ATPs, and that helps the conversion of nitrogen. And again, it is being converted to ammonia. And this is always a cyclic process. Now, how does this conversion happens? For us to understand this whole thing, we need to first understand about the components of nitrogenous complex. So what is there in it that makes it to convert, you know, the nitrogen to ammonia? Let us understand that. We have component one at the very beginning. So what does this do is, it makes possible that this is always making possible that this is always there. And component two is just an accessory component. Okay, component two is just an accessory component which just attaches to the component one. And this is only there to convert this ATP to ADP and to produce energy. And this component 2 is also called as azoferredoxin and consists of iron protein. This is mainly an iron protein, or they also, because of the redox reaction, that is the reductase reaction, you also call this as nitrogenase reductase enzyme. And then this is component one, that is molybdopyridoxine, consists of molybdenum iron sulfur cluster protein. And this is where the actual nitrogenase or actual the reaction is been always taking place. And molybdopyridoxine is an alpha 2, it's an alpha 2 and beta 2 type of tetramer. So that are usually encoded by NIF K and NIF D. Each tetramer contains 2 MO, that is molybdenum, and several of the Fe proteins, several of iron proteins, and some sulfur groups also will be present there. That whole consists of component one. Now this azofaridoxine is a dimer of identical subunits encoded by NIFH and contains a single iron protein, and also some of the sulfur groups will also be there, though, but mainly it's a iron protein. And it's a dimer, okay. When they get the signal, they get activated, and the production all of the proteins get started, and they ultimately start with the and ultimately help with the conversion of nitrogen to ammonia. So that's all about that. So summing up everything, to revise, you have the basic components of nitrogen fixation, that is nitrogenase enzyme complex. You have, and we also studied about the protective mechanism against oxygen, that is the leg hemoglobin, and ferredoxin, that is the component 2 and 1 also we studied, and we have constant supply of ATPs, all that we have just gone through. And nitrogen, there's an enzyme complex is how where much of the fixation is being carried on. We have these enzyme 2 and we have enzyme 1 complex, that is component 2 and component 1, which basically helps all these things. And this is what I told, it contains all the subunits inside it. It has been briefly described in this slide. So moving on, and this action of enzyme nitrogenase enzyme complex, I just told you how this is how you look at this electronic view of the complex structure over here. And we have molybdenum ferrous sulfur protein complex, and this is how the transfer of electrons is been happening, and how the component 2 is only concentrated on converting these ADPs to ATPs to ADP and IP is been shown here, how the reduction and oxidative process. And the next slide. And glutamine is actually is a structural part of a protein, and that is how it is been transferred via vessels, xylem vessels, and the nodules that ureates is being present, and amino acid polymerize the proteins. Finishing off with the current tutorial, we have this nitrogen cycle. All this time what we have studied with the help of the slides all sum up to the nitrogen cycle. Basically, nitrogen cycle is nothing but it's where the fixing of nitrogen has been happening, nitrogen fixation is happening, and by the plants, the plant proteins, by the dead and decay matter, and all these things, and plants proteins, all these things, and these are uptake by these the environment, surrounding environment. You have the nitrification, you have the ions which are responsible for it, and basically you have the atmospheric fixation, chemical fixation, and biological fixation, all three combined, and with the residues of the crop up and animal residues and animal decomposed, everything consumes each other, and again they denitrogenize to only to liberate into atmosphere, and again it is converted to fresh nitrogen, and again the cycle backs to the consuming of nitrogen to ammonia by the plants. So this process always, it's a cyclic, as you can see, it's a continuous process, and that is how the nitrogen cycle has been going on. So that's it, guys. So this is all about the nitrogen metabolism, nitrogen cycle, and all we have studied is that how the nitrogen is being metabolized by various factors. So thank you for the slide.